for tonight, but it must be a very big Independence Day, or whatever it's called, a big one coming, so people must be out shopping, but also it's often, you know, it is a bit nerve-wracking a day before, so if an event is free and open, often this is then where people decide, you know, I better should, you know, get my things in order, and I wish we had more people here. Normally, actually, we do. But we are also live streaming. This event is going to be on HowlRound, which is a national platform. So actually, the audience is much bigger than just the one here in the room. And we would like to thank again you all, the artists, for coming here. Really, it's nothing is more important to us than that we are in a dialogue, you know, as people create art or write words and perform them. This is what we do here nationally and internationally. And thanks to the Nuyorican Poetry Cafe and Daniel, especially for helping us to put this together. It came out of a conversation, and it would not have happened without you. So thank you so much. And I think it is important that we as organizations collaborate and do things, not just in our own places. And so everybody who comes to us, and normally that's theater with a dialogue and a dramatic act. So, you know, there are poets also are here. They are represented, after all. We're the New York Poets who created the off-Broadway movement. Probably they were the very first one to start what we now think is a given fact, but the people like the Frank O'Haras and others were the one who said, you know, we just get people together, we do our own thing, no one's going to care anyway. So we do poems, and then they also did plays. So this is at the very, very center of it in the great history of the Living Theater. With Judith Malina and Julian Back, if you look at their work, how closely it was related to the poets, how many friends they had, how many poets performed with them, plays they did, it shows the significance of it. And hopefully this is a little a connection to that world. My name is Frank Hentschker. I'm the director here of the Segal Theatre Center. And I would like to thank everybody on the team, Rebecca and Yu Chen and Veronica, Michael and Brett up there for the live streaming, and Bella for making this evening happen. And for creating the programs. We bridge academia and professional theater, international and American theater here. And this is actually the opening of our season. We had a big film festival. It was 40 films from 5 continents and 20 countries. But this is officially the opening. And we thought it is a very important thing. That's why we put it here in after this election and everything we experience. We feel there's a need and we have to hear voices. And we also have to give a space for it. So thank you for coming, but also thank you for thinking about what to do tonight and preparing and giving us your contribution. It shouldn't be longer than 90 minutes. Poets will perform, then there will be a panel discussion or discussion with you all here in the room, a little reception afterwards. And I hope we all will understand a bit more about the meaning of what it means to be alive and to be on this world and how to contribute and change things so we are part of the change we want to see. If you have a cell phone, now is the time just to take it out and take it off. Also, the poet's best is to have completely power off so it doesn't interfere with the mic we are recording. So take the mic here. You can take it off or put it back on or take this one. And now I would like to ask Daniel to say a few words. He's the director of that great cafe, Poets Cafe, the Nuyorican Poets Cafe, and we have such respect for you and your work, and the batting average of what you do there is just is stunning, and I really also would like to say in the name of the city of New York and the City University and everybody here how much we appreciate that, how much we respect it, and what a serious and great contribution it is to the cultural life in the city. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you. Much appreciated. We are very grateful to the Graduate Center and to Frank and Rebecca and all of the staff here for welcoming us. It's great to be back on this stage as well. I myself and some of our poets have been here previously for a number of events, including some of the No Passport conference events that have been hosted here. So my name is Daniel Gallant. I'm the director of the Nuyorican Poets Cafe. And the cafe, since its inception, has focused on the use of spoken word to address topics of political, social, and economic relevance and to explore the day-to-day lives of poets. We appreciate poetry in all of its forms, as a literary, but also as a spoken and a performative, and even as a competitive form. Since the mid-'80s, late-'80s, we've been increasingly associated with an art form known as slam poetry, which is a particular subset of performance poetry that involves competition between poets who write short pieces that tend to be percussive, tend to be socially and politically relevant, and tend to be personally and emotionally insightful as well. So today, you and I as well are all fortunate to hear from six of the really most accomplished, dynamic, and exciting performance poets that the cafe has the honor of working with. And all of these poets you're going to hear from today, they're accomplished writers, they're accomplished performers, they're accomplished competitors. They're also educators. And I think that's an important element to the discourse that we're engaging in tonight, and a discourse that runs through all of the programs that our organization offers, because we use poetry for entertainment, for commentary, but also to engage minds of all ages, to engage students in the civic process, in the political process. We as an organization are nonpartisan, but our poets are encouraged to be very partisan, very outspoken, very declarative, and very emotive from the time they get on our stage to the time they're touring through the city, through the country, and also when they're educating younger artists and helping people to find their performative voices. So tonight you're going to hear from six fantastic poets, and after each of them reads or performs a couple of poems, then we're going to have a talk back, a discussion with Frank and the artists, and we'll get to talk a little bit about what it is that informs and inspires the poetry that keeps our artists and our audiences engaged, and how our poets address the most pressing political, economic, and social topics of our time. So first up, I'm going to introduce Shanelle Gabriel, who's a singer, poet, and powerful advocate for lupus. Shanelle was born and raised in Brooklyn. She's widely known for both opening and featuring on HBO's Deaf Poetry Jam alongside Jill Scott and DMX, and has shared the stage with artists such as Talib Kweli, Nas, and more. Shanelle was spotlighted on The Rachel Ray Show, Huffington Post, by the NFL, and Women's Health Magazine. She's narrated audiobooks, and she's presently the program director at Urban Word NYC, which is a youth-focused organization that we work with on poetry slam and education programs often. So I'm very proud to welcome to the mic Shanelle Gabriel.
I was like, good afternoon, good evening. Good evening, everyone. All right, just so you know, I'm speaking on behalf of us. I know it's not many of us in here because we are all trying to weather the storm both outside in the world and politically. So, but if you like anything you hear, please feel free to make noise. Feel free to feel encouraged to be able to let us know that, okay? This is not a lecture. This is a shared experience. So the first piece I'm going to share with you all, just have a couple minutes. So I was trying to think of what I could do today, and one of the big things thinking about, I guess, a post-Obama America was one of the most interesting things is I think that they said that Obama was one of, he pulled a lot of people off of death row and reversed a lot of sentences for nonviolent crimes and situations of that nature. And thinking about mass incarceration and how the moment Trump got elected, the stocks to the prisons went up as opposed to everything else. Mass incarceration in America is a real thing. And thinking about that, I have this song, poem, rap thing that I kind of did, and I feel like I want to share that with you all. I have a new piece I'm going to share with you all, but I figure I'll start with this. And I'll slow it down just to hear the words. Today's noose is tied by the boys in blue. Police get promoted by demoting you. He's gassed because he's got power he's never had. Uneducated and armed, he does what he's told. And frisking black boys seems to be the way to go. Make them run their pockets so the public gets to show, then arrest them for the nickel bag they force them to expose. But don't check the Wall Street exec sniffing blow. See, if brown skin matched the color of cocaine, maybe sentencing would change. Since statistically they say whites get charged less. I remember Paris Hilton got away because it wasn't her purse that had the coke, because she borrowed it for the day. See, once they get you in the system, you become the system's slave. Read what the entire 13th Amendment says. It ends slavery except if you commit a crime, and black folk doing the time. Can't trust a system that don't trust you. Can't trust laws that just protect the few. Can't let them tell you that you ain't divine. They all lied, they ain't colorblind. Can't trust a system that don't trust you. Can't trust laws that made to break you. Can't have a plight that's undefied. They all lied, they ain't colorblind. The balance is off, their talent is lost. They can't see the skin color of the victims of brutality. See, we're living in a world that's little different from back when Rosa Parks stayed in her seat. The cops got Timothy in Cincinnati, Catherine in ATL, Robert out in Detroit, Eric Garner, Sean Bell. Equality's a hard sell when corporate crooks don't ever see a jail. When most of these people trying to make bail, when most of my brothers trying to make bail, while police planting drugs and lives to try to justify the hate they feel inside. They don't even know what stems from generations when they blatantly showed it. We gotta expose it. Obama can't save you. Locally and globally, expose the truth. We need to save our youth from being criminalized, because we need to save our youth from being criminalized, cause color's only bad when it's criminalized. Can't trust the system that don't trust you. Can't trust laws that just protect the few. Can't let them tell you that you ain't divine. They all lied, they ain't colorblind. Can't trust the system that don't trust you. Can't trust laws that just protect the few. Can't let them tell you that you ain't divine. They all lied, they ain't colorblind. Thank you. Don't worry, I turned the phone radio off. all right, so yeah, that piece I wrote, and it's funny, it's on my second album, and there was all these background things I had to think of, and I ended up actually going to my sister's school because I had this idea of having kids on the track, saying, And I had to explain it to them because I was like, I'm not just gonna use them as a soundbite. I said, so what do you think is something that makes you different from everybody else? And one kid said, I like, you know, some cartoon. Another kid said, I like that cartoon too. And I was like, okay, well, you thought that made you different, but there's so much alike about all of us, right? But what do you think about people that think because you like, I think it was, he said, he liked, they were really small. He said, not Dora, Doc McStuffins. I said, what do you think if somebody says because you like Doc McStuffins, you're like, they shouldn't play with you? That's terrible. And then we try to explain that. But it's such a very simple concept, and when you look at our society and look at the way that the laws that are coming in place are unfolding, it's actually not. It should be easier than it is. But all right, so I was like playing with this piece, and I really wanted to try to share it. So you guys are like the first to hear this, okay? So go easy on me. Yeah. So I. Thinking about this. I remember high-fiving strangers, car horns blaring like emancipation. Union Square Park was an impromptu block party celebration. Even chess players took a break from their money-making deliberation to join the jubilation. See, Obama became president of our nation. It was like we spent years trying to double dutch, and the world stopped trying to choke us with the ropes. Society finally moved in sync, allowed a black man to jump in. Praise God he had rhythm. Steps quickened when Congress sped up and slowed down their pace, but it was great to see some remnants of sanity in the Oval Office. Amidst the pride of the era, we made the error of not thinking, what's next? Someone jumping in that we didn't expect. Forget jumping in, this person stole a rope, treated like this was a game, and I know manhunt when I see it. Everything all fun and laughs till someone loses an eye or a constitution. Or the progress it took 8 years to build. Am I the only one filled with trepidation when I crack open a newspaper? And I'm the only one, am I the only one afraid? Am I the only one who doesn't know how to explain to a generation who never had to choose the lesser of two evils, who didn't know what it's like to have candidates with scandals, with multiple wives? How do we explain democracy when we have empty seats meant for checks and balances? When only people of color politicians consider Americans have to be spray tanned, what do I say to make the orange boogeyman go away? To comfort those who know that things can and will get worse before they change. Our president, with his shovel of a tongue, digging the graves of those who can no longer migrate to keep their families safe. What do I say to comfort the child on the train, afraid her mom will be sent away? Will the dreamers awaken to ICE, chipping away at their future? Repeals ripping healthcare away at the seams. How do I teach them to close their eyes? count from 1 to 5, to breathe, to believe it can't get any worse, to breathe, to believe your legacy still has worth, to breathe, to be comforted by the fact that this isn't the last time you'll have to be your own president, and it sure isn't the first. Thank you.
Give it up for Shanelle Gabriel. And you know, as Shanelle was pointing out in her poetry, spoken word is a very effective way to engage younger people, students, those who might be disaffected by traditional academic pursuits or might not always find an obvious way to engage in the civic process or the electoral process. Spoken word can be a good way in, and Shanelle certainly in her work with Urban Word has helped to demonstrate ways in which this art form can be used to inspire and energize and engage younger students and artists. Next up, I'm going to introduce Advocate of Wordz, who is an award-winning performance poet, published author, and teaching artist. He's a Brio Award winner. He received a Taino Image Award with the group El Grito de Poetas. His work has been featured or covered by PBS, the LA Times, CNN, Fox News, and Univision. He's performed and lectured at Princeton, Lincoln Center, Georgetown University, and of course, the Nuyorican. And he's the creator of Hip-Hop Poetry and Poetry Defined, which are both online resources for performance poets. So without further ado, let me call to the stage Advocate of Wordz.
Maybe I smoked too much. Maybe I wrote too much. Or maybe I spoke too much. But yo, I'm so gone. Like election votes in the US survey, like liberty in the media in the US survey, yo, I'm so gone. Like unlike Nibiru in outer space, slowly getting next to you, I'm so gone. Like truth in the media, like chivalry, ladies, I see how they treating you, I'm so gone. Like my breath when I rhyme, better yet, like features to poets who don't show up on time. I'm so gone to always trying to make amends when most homicides are committed by family and friends. Yo, I'm so gone, I got a one-way ticket to the moon, Apollo 11. I'ma see if they really did it. I'm so gone, reptilians can have the planet, but I'm not leaving quietly, my exit will be dramatic. I'm so gone, I'm taking everything I got receipts for, Billy Joe CD, Foreman Grill, I'm ex-girlfriend's kid Seesaw. Yo, I'm so gone, like our species are out the hanky-panky, like last season with A-Rod and the Yankees, like I'm so gone, like the bag of fucks I had to give, like the love for dark-skinned women from the feminist. I'm so gone, I gotta get off this rock, cause when it comes to natural disasters, we don't look at people, we look at stocks. So gone, so gone. It won't be on TV, but in your heart, so says Gil Scott Heron. I'm so gone, I need to reclaim myself. Sometimes being humble means you just playing yourself. I'm so gone, I ain't mean to damage your nerves. I ain't a rapper, man. I'm just an advocate of words. What's going on, y'all? Good evening. Thank you for having me. So my name is Advocate of Wordz, real quick. In high school, one of my friends read a poem to a girl. She fell in love with him, and I was like, that's it, I'm gonna become a poet. For like 5-6 years, I was horrible at it because I wasn't being sincere about it. And then I started to find my love for poetry. And I did a lot of that in the beginning at the Nuyorican Poets Cafe before I had the fortune of performing there. And one day someone read something of mine. They're like, oh, you're a poet. And I felt like, no, I'm more like an advocate of words. And that's how the moniker stuck. So that's something relatively new that I've written. I'm in the middle of writing a novel, so I haven't written too much poetry of late. So thank you very much. It's not easy. It's not easy. Just say, oh, you going through the process? You awesome. Just the process. So the last poem I'm going to share with you is relatively old, but and when I mean old, I mean like 7-8 years old. But unfortunately, it's still so it's very much relevant today and to what we're talking about. So, the Bronx Latina Supreme Court Justice. It sounds as sour as Hispanic Heritage Month. I refuse the ideologies that imply the importance of my country, my culture be marginalized to 30 days. They must have made a slip of the tongue. must have thought that we could not understand their language, as if it's shocking that a resident from the Bronx has a grasp on this country's laws. Like it's an anomaly that a Puerto Rican isn't always bailando, or cocinando, or fucking. We don't have to wait till late September to understand what the Southwestern and Central Hemisphere's cultures have done for modern day society. This woman's blood is Taino warrior, European conquistador, and African royalty. She is as American as Frederick Douglass, Joe DiMaggio, double taxation without representation, the Four Seasons, shopping malls, and conspiracy theories. Someone must think that this melting pot of a country contains onion soup with a white cheesy covering. But last I checked, being a woman born of any race on United States soil is as American as it gets, as pure as it gets. Your Honor, never let them call you the Bronx Latina Supreme Court Justice like you're some distinct charity case. Never, ever will you hear Advocate of Wordz saying that white people are the enemy, because they're not. But they can no longer be viewed as the sole generic embodiment of this country either. As a fellow Nuyorican who is a proud Bronx resident, it is warming to see you receive this new job. But you in this specific instance are their equal. So I'm gonna respect you as such and refer to you as such. So, congratulations, Sonia Sotomayor, an American Supreme Court Justice.
Give it up for Advocate of Wordz, ladies and gentlemen. And one of the things I admire about Advocate is also how he combines a lot of different performance styles and some of the elements that I consider to be why spoken word is such an entertaining and engaging and a flexible art form, a mix of theater, a mix of comedy, a mix of political and social discourse. So I enjoy seeing how you combine all those styles, and I'm always impressed by your work. Next up, I'm going to call to the mic Jennifer Falu, a celebrated performance artist who performs throughout New York City and across the country. She was a member of the 2006, 2009, 2012, and 2014 Nuyorican Poets Cafe Slam Teams, which is not easy to do. To get onto a slam team at the cafe or any other circuit, you have to win a bunch of slams, and then you get to compete at the national level. So Jennifer is a veteran of R and other slams, and she really knows her stuff. She became the top female poet of the year in 2006, ranked third in both the 2009 and 2012 National Slams, and was one quarter of the Tri-State Area's first all-female poetry slam team. She shared the stage with Jennifer Holliday and Patti LaBelle. She made her film debut in the movie Mania Days, as well as RZA's Coco, an upcoming movie that co-stars Jill Scott and Common, and she's featured in a documentary that follows the 2016 Brooklyn Slam Team. She's also a Cave Canem Fellow of 2016. Please welcome to the stage Jennifer Falu.
So there's this sales tax on tampons. And it's not seen as a necessity like food and medicine, except it's not something that we can control, therefore making pads and tampons a necessity. So I'm gonna do this poem because we walk outside and our bodies and our uteruses are seen as such a negative thing, and I'm gonna tell you a story about how my mother reacted when I got my period for the first time. You can also use the hashtag happy to bleed or free the tampon. I've been bleeding for a spell or two. unknowingly ruining my garments and letting the warm run down my leg. The first time it happened, I tried to look inside of my own body and make sure there wasn't no extraterrestrials coming out. I'm almost certain my mama told me about menstruation, and so did Aunt Missy. Aunt Missy would tell this story about how she got her period, and she told her mama, "I don't want this shit." And I would laugh hysterically because Aunt Missy is hysterical about most anything. So I guess when I got my period, I didn't want it so much, I didn't even realize I had it. I just figured I needed to wash better. Blood will make you dirty, you know. I learned that early, that it'll change you, make you smell different, make you walk different. Well, the walk could just be the pads, but... But the altering power that a red stain on your clean drawers can make was enough to make me ignored for 4 more days and 2 more months after that. Each time I felt that warm, I would run to the bathroom, make a tissue pad, and plead to whatever God was in charge of my ovaries not to let the tissue fall out during dance class. I mean, I thought about asking Aunt Missy what it was supposed to look like, because it wasn't no way I had my period, but I figured she done gave all her blood away. Ain't that what God be doing? So why when a woman shed hers, it ain't clean? I waited until the 4th month to tell my mother that by my body's clock, I was a woman. She gasped so hard, I thought she would swallow me whole. Those grass green eyes darting back and forth looking to see if I transformed. I never told her that I had already been shifting by myself for 3 months. Never said that the day I came home and told her was the day it dawned on me that it was what it was. I ain't too sure if I was too embarrassed to say, now I got on clean panties today, but I've been throwing away all the messy ones because I didn't want you to think you couldn't leave me in charge of my own vagina, because knowing your vagina is your vagina is important. It's something about claiming ownership over an object that makes us humans behave like beasts. My mama, though, she had like this period kit already waiting for me. And she was prepared to let me think my body was mine, leasing me to myself, but keeping the title on her person at all times. And I kicked myself for not telling her earlier, because every month after that, for the first day of my period, she would let me stay home from school. And we'd spend the day lying around in our pajamas, drinking tea and eating snacks. Every so often, she'd buy me flowers or a small gift. Every so often, she'd make me feel like I was spotless. So, I miss Obama. I just miss the cool of him, the ease of him. Donald Trump gives me anxiety. I feel like his feet stink. It's just, it's weird. Like, I feel like Melania's scared and frightened. It's just weird. It's weird. It's weird. I don't know. So this is a poem for Barack Hussein Obama. There is a candlelight in the belly of a man. Wax drips over the rib cage. Liver. Imagined you lying down, your blood red heart pumping courage throughout the body, flickering flame in your eyes. We say wink, smooth, cool down. You say, time is now. Our watch is past noon. Anticipation in the throats of others, same skin color, same struggle. We say, please, Mr. President, wave for me. Kiss your daughters. Cock your shotgun. Time is now. Long time coming. Say Hussein. Say America is silly. Say if my people who are called by my name humble themselves, so say my name. Say your son's name out loud, say movement, say too long we've been hanging from trees, on ropes, on corners, on couches, say we got up, say we read, say we be battling, making our own, say vest, please, say Barack, your smile is bulletproof, your words, honest. Say what evidence shows that an intricate support system starts from the foundation. Say Obama. Say you strapped. Say you steadfast. Say how the water is so big and your boat is so small. Say, but if my people who were called by my name humble themselves, so humble yourself. Say you ain't no chicken. Say they come home to roost. Say they keep trying to make us all feather and cartilage, but say we fly. Say we fly. Say we America. Say we be bald eagle and apple pie. Say we want our watermelon on the side. Say that's what you think, nigga. We pump our fist. We beat our drums. We name our children after God. Say we colored. Say we live in color. Say we ain't come to paint the White House black. Let's say we wrap it in slave ship. You motherfuckers don't want no trouble. We just want what's ours. Say we ain't afraid. Say we here. Say his name. Say God. Say God. Say there's a candlelight in the belly of a man. But say that you see our eyes. They flicker too.
Jennifer Falu, ladies and gentlemen. Jennifer is a veteran of the slam scene. She knows this art form like nobody's business. And she's also a fantastic educator and mentor to students all over. So we're very glad to have you here. Next up, I'm going to call to the microphone the 2016 Nuyorican Grand Slam champion, Jaime Lee Lewis. He's an educator and inspirational speaker from New York City. I'm just going to sing a few more of your praises and then come on up. He's been active in the New York City art scene for many years. He's built a solid reputation as a community organizer and innovator. He created a one-man show called Unconditional, and he's the author of a book called Being. He is a fantastic poet, writer, performer, and all-around human being, so we are glad to have you. May I call to the mic Jaime Lee Lewis.
You hear me? You good? All right. I'll project. So I have a poem entitled Dear Africans in America. It's actually a collection of 28 short poems. As follows. Dear Africans in America. One, you are not stolen goods. Your skin is your receipt. Evidence that your life was purchased and paid for with the lives of those that arrived before you. Survival kit genetics, you are the moment your ancestors were waiting for, too. Freedom is not a luxury, it is a responsibility. What do you take responsibility for? Three, you are the promise the North Star made to Harriet. You are the generation that visited Martin in his sleep. You are the letter Malcolm wrote from Mecca and the epiphany he found hidden behind blue eyes. You are the 27 years Nelson spent in prison. You are the reason he missed his mother's funeral. You are the seat Rosa Parks refused to give up. You are sacred. You are precious. You are the hope of a people. Four, white people are not your enemy. Harriet Tubman freed over 300 slaves, but she didn't do it alone, and she surely didn't free herself without help. To blindly place an assumption-sown blanket of anger over an entire race is not revolutionary. That is irresponsible. Five, I am less fearful of police officers killing our children and more fearful that their favorite rappers will kill their perception of reality and self-worth. I watched my generation go from being the finish line to being merely a checkpoint in this repetitive cycle. Many of our peers are proof that there are numerous ways to take a person's life. Whether we choose to rationalize it or not, we are collectively preparing our children for the lives we decide they deserve. Six, you must study history in order to pass the test of time. Seven, you are fighting for your life, not the lives of others. That's why bullets are not afraid of you. Racist men don't even hide under bed covers anymore. According to the prophets, your tactics are too televised to be the revolution. Roaches in the spotlight, we are scattered, quick to set it off, slow to set the example. Love and respect cannot be legislated. Pray for a promised land you will not live to see and take your people there, Moses. 8. For civilizations and for centuries, the only time men are not at home is when they are at war. And our men are at war with themselves, with the world that has labeled their strength an act of terrorism. Corporate America, like Vietnam, there are kids still waiting for their fathers to come home as they are left to be raised by a mother he is already dead to. 9. We breathe together, laugh and cry from our bellies. We gasp for air together. We stumbling through this life. We stepping on each other's toes. We learning to walk together. Skin all shades of telepathic. If you are my mirror, I am beautiful. 10. I love the way your body blushes, like you have a crush on the sun, like you got kissed on the skin for the first time, like the sun wears brown lipstick that you've promised to never wash off. Your skin is so faithful. 11. When did you become African American? When did any of America's founding fathers ask God to have Africa's hand in marriage? Plantation ceremony, we were socially conditioned to say I do. No honeymoon, just one's culture hyphenated like it were a last name. 12. We pass each other in the street. We are love notes making our way across the classroom, afraid of having the sentiments of our heart intercepted. Our nonchalance is unnatural, and lust is just a defense mechanism. Being black shouldn't feel this voyeuristic. 13. You're scared to love me in public. We only hold hands when we marching. 14. We family, but we only come together at funerals. 15. Confession, the first time I got stopped and frisked was on my way to school at the age of 13 by 3 black boys that lived in the neighborhood in which I attended junior high school. 16. We don't die, we multiply, but we're divided. That don't add up. 17. Social injustice is what happens when the tastemakers are not the taste testers. This country's appetite is hard to digest, and black people are America's upset stomach. 18. There are black sheep in the black community, black chickens that decide at best they not come home to roost, opting rather for a nest nestled away in the warm welcome of white suburbs. Black stones refused often turn out to be the chosen ones, and only then do those who deny them start hitting them up like, let's build. 19. We've been divided since house nigger and field nigger, since slave states and free states, since enslaved blacks and freed blacks, since auction block, since dark skin and light skin, since uneducated Negro and educated Negro, since Booker T. Washington and W.E.B. Du Bois, since upper class, lower class, and middle class, since Martin, since Malcolm. 20. The hate in the hood is so contagious. Most of us hate the hood, because most of us are convinced the hood hates us. However, secretly, every kid from the hood wants the hood to love them. Because if the hood loves you, in your head, the world loves you. And then maybe, just maybe, you might be allowed to love yourself too. 21. You cannot overthrow white supremacy with black supremacy. You can only overpower white supremacy with black solidarity. That is to say, to meet your white brother's hatred with black hatred is ineffective. White hate must be met with black love. 22. Black boys expect to die. Black girls expect their bodies to be used for a pleasure that is not their own. Every year beyond 25 makes a black boy feel like he cheated death. An orgasm makes a black girl feel like she cheated the system. 23. I will no longer use the color of our struggle to rationalize the crimes we commit against our own. Being anti-white does not make you pro-black. 24. There are leaders amongst you, ready, hungry, but unclear as to who they're fighting for, what they're fighting for, who they're fighting against, and who they're fighting with. They understand the subtle difference between war and conflict, and they are not sure if it is wise to go to war with an army of men pointing guns, with an army of men pointing fingers. 25. Hope is a black girl in Brooklyn, is a brown baby taking his first step in West Side Chicago, was a light-skinned girl in Atlanta who used to be in love with her perm, but has suddenly developed a serious crush on her new growth, is a black boy in Oakland whose love for his own has recently grown too big for, to fit in the word nigger, is the black genetics of a fetus in the belly of a mother who just chose single parenthood over Planned Parenthood. Hope is another chance, disguised as a child, God's mercy in the form of a generation. 26. The first funeral I ever attended was for an aunt that was murdered. A third grader should not be able to peer into a casket looking for the bullet holes in his aunt's body. Yet we are taught to stop snitching. The message no longer free Mandela, now we free Boosie, now we free Max B. Now by all means, I understand the plight of black men who sit in courtrooms with their lifestyles sitting on the witness stand testifying against them. However, it is hard to ignore the fact that the hood lets killers walk too. So how does a black man speak life into this culture of rationalized killing? How do I tell you, you will not turn my child into a t-shirt line? 27. I am child of African export, child of black America, child of the hood, child of immigrants, child of a single parent home, child of absentee father, child of those below the poverty line, child of darker skin. I too was born with all the reasons we are not supposed to succeed, born into a society that resists me, born without the luxury of seeing oppression as a political issue. It will always be personal. 28. I am not fighting for equal rights. I'm not fighting against oppression. I'm fighting for something the white race can never give me. I'm fighting for your love. Fighting to piece together this broken mirror we've become. I just want us to love our reflection again. Keep the 40 acres and the mule. I just want our fathers back. I just want to give our sisters their crowns back. Fighting for something realer than real estate. Because you can gentrify a neighborhood, but you can't gentrify a community. Thank you. I feel like that might have been my whole time, so yeah. Thank you, y'all. It's been real. Cool.
Jaime Lee Lewis, ladies and gentlemen. There's a lot of wisdom in that verse. That's some very impressive material. One of the things that you do that I admire a lot is that you move very deftly from the personal to the global, and from intimate interpersonal commentary to much larger societal conflicts and tensions. And that takes a lot of finesse and a lot of insight. So I admire that a great deal. All right, that was Jaime Lee Lewis. We have two more poets, and then we head into the panel discussion. Saroya Marsh is a nationally ranked poet performer who works as a teacher and a youth mentor, and she's fantastic at all of those roles. She was a finalist in the 2013 Poetry Idol, 2013 Inspired Wordz Slam Master Jam Champion, 2014 Nuyorican Grand Slam Champion, and captain of the first all-female slam team in the tri-state area where she represented the Nuyorican. She ranked second in the world at the Women of the World Poetry Slam. She took home the Nuts Championship as a member of Team Reparations. She's been featured in The Village Voice, The Huffington Post, Blavity, Def Jams, All Def Digital, and most recently on Lexus Versus and Flow and many other venues. Please welcome to the stage, Saroya Marsh.
My name is Saroya Marsh. I'm a black poet who refuses to remain silent while this nation continues to murder black people. I have a right to be angry. I'm building me a home. I'm building me a home. This earthly house is gonna soon decay. And my soul's got somewhere to stay. Gentry, gentrify, gentrification. Good evening, almighty big sister, Uncle Tom, man. I solemnly swear to uphold the mission of restoration and upgrading of deteriorating urban properties, often resulting in the displacement of lower income people. I get what you meant by projects. You move me in, stigmatize me, then kick me out and raise rent and whitewash my hood with some hipsters and Coke bottle glasses and chewed up Converse that will clutch their purse when I walk by tighter than a church mother holds her Bible. You get an A+. You know, when I hear drink and draw, I think a bottle of Hennessy and a game of spades, and yeah, my people push crack rock, but that rock landed on us. We don't own any planes. We don't own any names. Jackson, Johnson, Darren Wilson, I will remind officers, no, that's not a gun. That's my wallet, my iced tea, my bare hands. No, I will not sell Lucy's or CDs on corners. Fuck it. I will not sell Lucy's or CDs on corners, because either way, I might die. And speaking of death, thank you for replacing that crown fried chicken with a bistro with overpriced craft beers, because we know way more people die from chicken-induced comas than they do from drunk driving. And Mr. Softy, who, we only eat Froyo on my block. I have fallen victim to the ever-so-delightful caramel macchiato. Fuck yeah, I signed that petition to stop the construction of Starbucks. With a fake name, allowing them to bleach the black out of the Bronx and Brooklyn. Now my preschool sells unlimited mimosas. Yes, my people are leaving. Call it reverse migration, institutionalization, incarceration, or just plain murder. In any case, something dies. Ain't enough water in the faucet to wash away these sins. I pledge to be a member of G5C, Gentrification Incorporated. I uphold our founding father, Christopher Columbus's mission to make a home of stolen goods. And if you see me praying, just know I'm building me a home. My name is Saroya Marsh, and I'm a black poet who refuses to remain silent while this nation continues to murder black people. I have a right to be angry. An ode to the color purple, or black women bleed too. Dear God, I could write the most beautiful poem, but the dick to the throat gets me the 10. The bullet to the head gets her a rally in a vacant lot. I wonder how they say her body was riddled with bullets. Was it no mystery? Was it nothing funny? Only black and blood. Who you think you is? You can't curse nobody. You poor, you black, you're ugly, you're a woman, you're nothing at all. Sister, you have the right to be made silent. Anything you say can and will be erased, and the killer goes free. I just stand back and see what the ground gonna look like. See what kind of bodies they gonna put on there now. Tanisha, Tarika, Rakia, Ayana, Corinne, Sandra Bland sat in that jail. I sat in that jail till I near done about rocked to death. I know what it like to want to go somewhere and can't. I know what it like to want to sing and have it beat out of you and the killer still goes free. You know, I think it pisses cops off when they walk past the color purple in a field and don't shoot at it. And don't nobody want to say her name. Only want her to scream theirs. Scream daddy don't. Please don't hurt my kids. See daddy, sinners have souls too. Him too, been built in this body. Done forgot just how much woman he actually is. Done forgot this body be forest and steeple threatened by wind and fire and bullet and fist. And the color purple is awarded to those wounded in action. Well, all my life I had to fight to be black and woman and queer and breathing all at once is a war all on its own. Until you do right by me, I am learning that loving myself is a deliberate act, like black, seeing black for the first time, seeing it ain't the darkness they say it is. Until you do right by me, I am learning that my black is beautiful. Everything you done to me is coming right back. Amen. My name is Saroya Marsh. I am a black poet who will not remain silent while this nation continues to murder black people. I have a right to be angry.
Saroya Marsh, ladies and gentlemen. Saroya has one of the most powerful and unique and memorable poetic voices that I have had the good fortune to ever hear. And there's a lot of truth and musicality and power and activism in your voice. And I'm grateful to have you here. Thank you for being here. All right, ladies and gentlemen, the final poet of the night before we go into the panel discussion is Pamela Sneed, a New York-based poet, writer, and actress who's been featured in the New York Times Magazine, The New Yorker, Time Out, Bomb, Vibe, and on the cover of New York Magazine. She's the author of Imagine Being More Afraid of Freedom Than Slavery, published by Henry Holt, Kong and Other Works, published by Vintage, and a chapbook called Lincoln. In 2015, she published the chapbook Gift with Belladonna. She's performed at Lincoln Center, PS122, in Mexico City, in London, Glasgow, Scotland, Manchester, England, at the BAM Cafe, Joe's Pub, the Public Theater, Central Park Summer Stage, Bronx Summer Stage, Columbia University, and many, many other venues. Please welcome to the stage the fabulous Pamela Sneed.
Good evening. Good evening.
Good evening.
Hi. Wow. I had just begun to relax, celebrate the marriage equality ruling. I had just begun feeling with Obama I was watching Ali in trouble off the ropes, delivering to his opponent the rope-a-dope, my father's eyes, excitement. I was just beginning to breathe air, feel exhilarated at images of Joe Biden and President Obama running down halls of the White House with rainbow flags like boys with kites soaring. I was just beginning to forgive deaths of my brothers to AIDS, not forget there should still be tribunals for them and every woman abused by the medical system. I was just beginning to turn a corner on Mike Brown, Freddie Gray, Trayvon Martin, Eric Garner, the massacre at AME, not think of it all every day. And then the police kill this young black girl in custody in Texas, claim she committed suicide, and I remember we're a war nation. In war times, I imagine how James Bayard Nina felt seeing a nation turn its dogs, teeth, gas, hoses, bullets on children and adults. I can't stop thinking about Steve Biko, his battered face. They say he hung himself too, the world's outrage. Who will pray for us now, America? If you want to know the ending, how it's all going to turn out, the aftermath of a Trump presidency, don't turn to analysts, Wall Street, or CNN for an accurate portrait of where it's all going, what it's going to look like. Reread Octavia Butler's Parable of the Sower, set in California around 2027. People in fear, behind walls, gated communities, a woman raped so much she can't stand. Gun violence, addiction, fires that can scarcely be put out. People scavenging for food, trying not to become prey. Compassion is gone. The main character's name, Lauren, is a hyper empath. She can feel others' pain, which I think is a metaphor for artists. Whatever you think of Marina Abramović, her show title is right. The artist is, was always present. From the beginning of time till now, look again at the Hunger Games. The districts are actually concentration camps with gray garb and barbed fences that nod to Nazi Germany. Human beings are pitted against each other to survive. And sometime after Trayvon Martin was shot, I finally understood something deep about Star Wars. I always rooted for the good guys, always. And once I heard a friend at the movies rooting for Poison Ivy, Batman, and Batgirl's nemesis, and I was shocked that anyone could root for a bad girl. But after Trayvon was killed by George Zimmerman, who walked free, I finally understood what could turn a character's eyes dark. You could become so disillusioned. And then I understood in the Star Wars franchise what made Darth Vader, Vader. I felt that again after Trump's election. No more green, blue light, only gray, dark, drab, white bones, war. And last week I worked with a class I hadn't met before on the subject of Black Lives Matter. I repeated something to Greg said to a group of students, what if the only justice we have right now is here in this room? And one student said, well, nothing ever changes. So I responded by asking them, are you telling me then that you can't change? They were all surprised, shocked by my question. At the end of the class, I asked, what have you learned today? And a black girl answered as if she were channeling Octavia herself, change. It's up to us. Mm-hmm. 16 years old from the suburbs, Boston. I go into the city shopping with my cousin and friends. We'd venture into Boston Commons, the park. There were hustlers there I didn't know then with a set up table. They played some sort of game with shells, hid money under a shell or a plastic cup. Moved their hands real quick, made it purposefully look so easy, naive, 16 years old, I bet. $50, a lot of money for me then. They made it look so easy, you just had to pick the right one. Of course, it was rigged. I lost, felt dizzy, sick to my stomach, lost my gaze. On Tuesday night after this election, I felt the same way, heisted in a shell game. Walking outside on Wednesday in my neighborhood, a white woman who barely ever speaks was crying and asked, "What do we do?" And I answered earnestly, "A teacher, an artist, a professor who always tries, I don't know." And later I walked up the street, a white man in an SUV with the window down drove by. He wore an expensive business suit, had a big brown cigar like when babies are born, expensive, seen only in gangster films like Goodfellas or The Sopranos after a kill. He looked happy, smug, and that's when I realized the Trump presidency is a hustler's game, baller's club, players only, pimp paradise. Wise with teased hair and lots of plastic surgery on the white BET. They made it all look so easy, like a choice. Who knew the American dream was a side hustle for big businessmen with all their ugly red, white, blue striped flag merchandising available at Walmart and Target? I'll never buy into again. Who knew? Freedom was a marketing idea, a consumer product, hallucinatory drug cooked up in some Rovian, as in Carl, type of laboratory sweatshop maintained by the architects of apartheid. Freedom, like air if you're white and male and rich enough to keep breathing. Today, I started to cry as I wrote to my students, knowing that in everything so far, I've tried to protect them and realizing that there are places in this world that even my maternal hands can't reach. In Poland, the Warsaw Ghetto against a Nazi fascist regime, on southern plantations and fields in Haiti, on the shores of Africa, uprising, the 60s, the streets, James, Nina, Bayard, Miriam, June, Nikki, Lorraine, Audrey, Pat, Malcolm, Martin, Betty, Sekou, the unnamed artists, poets, teachers, always uprising.
Thank you. Pamela Sneed, ladies and gentlemen. Pamela, there is a beauty and power to your words that transcends the page and the voice, and somehow you managed to be amazing and transcendent in both forms, and it's a blessing to have you here as well. Thank you so much for sharing that fantastic work with us. Ladies and gentlemen, those are our six poets, and now I'm going to turn the mic back over to Frank, I guess. We have a panel discussion now. So we're going to bring out some chairs, and poets, if you'd be willing to join us on stage.
Like check 1, 2.
Check. Oh, okay.
Yeah. Check. Yeah.
1, 2.
The mic sounds not.
Yep. Check.
Well, so I'm blown away by what we heard today, and I'm guessing that our audience probably is just as impressed, if not more so than I am. I'm deeply honored to be able to be in the presence of six such transcendent artists, and thank you all for sharing such amazing work with us. What I would love to hear from each of you is a little bit of discussion about what it means across the various roles that each of you hold as educators, as writers, as performers, as activists, how you negotiate the changing times that we're in, and how in each of those roles you communicate what are incredibly vital messages. I'd like to start actually with the idea of educators, because I know that each of you work as teachers, as mentors, as instructors, and in some cases as coaches to rising artists and to young poets. And I wondered if each of you or any of you who are willing to could talk a little bit about what it means to inspire in younger artists not just love of the art form, but the importance of using the art form for socially relevant purposes, and how to inspire a sense of activism in younger artists and younger audiences.
Well, as a new staff member at Urban Word, but I've worked as a teaching artist for about 12 years now. Oh my gosh, 12 years now. One, I think it's very easy to get young people to get the idea of self-expression, but also I think the importance of teaching artists is to help them also be able to pull from other sources, other influences around them, the world around them, and to see that for a lot of them, the issues that they face is not just them. There are social issues that lead to the conditions that help that they're expressing, you know. So when a young person's speaking about, you know, my parent not being present, or, you know, or the struggle of living life that they live, and it's like, okay, well, let's talk about the cycle of poverty, and let's talk about what that looks like. So there's so many layers to working with young people where I always say that, I think we were talking about it, no matter when you're working with young people, you're a social worker, whether you want to be or not, whether you have the degree or not, you know, you are dealing with a lot. And I think the role of a teaching artist, and especially in the climate that we're in today, is to help them process their own feelings about things. Because a lot of times you ask them and they shrug their shoulders, but it's just us being able to channel what's already there. They know the answers. They don't always have the language. They know what's wrong. They know there's something wrong, but they don't know how to. They don't know where it comes from. They don't know that it's bigger than just them. So I think that that's our duty as, you know, older, as another generation, as educators, as well as just human beings interacting with younger human beings, to help them navigate this entire space, and even on a higher level than even was offered to myself.
I think, is my mic on? You hear me? All right, cool. I think to piggyback on what Chanel just said.
You just skipped over me.
Oh, my bad. Oh, I didn't. I thought it was jumping.
It's fine by me.
I'll go after.
No, go ahead.
I'll be quick. But yeah, so just to piggyback on what Chanel said, you know, I think the unique thing about education, you know, I don't want to say as opposed to entertainment, but let's say that. I think entertainment generally diverts one's attention from, you know, what's going on, like, and channels it more into an area of amusement. But when you, you know, like many of us working in education, it allows us, myself in particular, to talk to the students from the realm of reality and opening up a dialogue about humanity. And I think once you get the students or the kids or just people to talk about the human experience, naturally we begin to talk about social issues. You know, and I think, you know, as Chanel said, it's, you know, once you get the conversation going to their humanity, and then you give them the tools to then articulate what they're actually feeling and experiencing, what happens is you get the narratives about poverty, about abuse, about, you know, sexuality, about, you know, just politics in general. You get their perspective on things. I think the major thing for me is always to get back to humanity. You know, to get beyond beliefs, beyond religion, beyond gender. When I say beyond gender, yes, there are the different, you know, the different experiences within each group, but getting to the human experience, the things that make the difference between being alive and not, you know, being here tomorrow and not, having those conversations, getting to those fears and concerns, I think it becomes automatically understood that you have the power to say something that can change the outcome.
Go ahead, Pamela.
So, okay, so I teach on the college level, so but last year I was actually the writer in residence for PoetLink at Lincoln Center, but and we have an anthology coming out at the end of the month, and it's available for pickup. It's PoetLink, and it's all these really great young people throughout the city. So if you want to, like, you know, check out some really diverse, you know, voices and some really great, you know, young poets. I work with people that are intergenerational. I work with, like, a lot of different people from a lot of different ages. One of the ways that I start every class is with Audre Lorde, The Transformation of Silence into Language in Action, and Poetry is Not a Luxury. And it doesn't matter what age. I mean, I've started, like, with 16-year-old. I mean, there's, like, I think there was a kid that was in eighth grade. I don't know how old that is, right? But
But basically, I've taught that. I've started with that from like, you know, eighth graders to people who are like 60. And so that is my script. So the first thing that we discuss, and that kind of like sets the context for what it is that I want to talk about. And I mean, again, you know, the first thing she says is the personal is political. And I also teach that. Poetry is not a luxury, again, so that people begin to understand the value of poetry in the culture. And then also Dorothy Allison's Deciding to Live. And that piece is like one of my favorite essays in the sense that it talks about coming to the word or coming to voice as a way of deciding to live, right? As a way of claiming one's life. And I think that that's an incredible place to start. And that frees people up, you know, immediately they're like, whoa, you know, but I find a lot of people become brave in that work. And then specifically with the Trump stuff, I've basically taken articles out that criticize him, that talk about, you know, the government, the spectacle, all of this, because I'm trying to give people a language with which to critique it. Because a lot of times people are really overwhelmed by what's going on, and it's a very sophisticated kind of manipulation that we're all under. And so I find being able to kind of break down that manipulation and show people and give them a language with which to critique it is a very powerful way of getting them to kind of fight back. So.
Thank you. Jennifer, yeah. Do you have any thoughts?
Oh, I mean, I can.
If you, yeah,
So I have middle school, 6th, 7th, and 8th grade. So for me, it's really important, aside from politics, my motto in life is love above all things. And I always start with self-love. And then we can go to other forms of love. There is nothing wrong with an unapologetic love for oneself. So I make statements to them, by the way I come to work every day, by the way I dress, by the way I speak to them, by the way I interact with them. I am very clear with them that I live in the same neighborhood as them, and that if every morning I wake up and I take pride in myself, then every morning you can wake up and you can take pride in yourself as well. I don't think that Roy and I have ever did a workshop together that hasn't started with Audre Lorde. Come celebrate with me something has tried to kill me and failed. I don't think that we have done a single workshop where we have not started with that. And that is the motto, always. Come celebrate with me that something has tried to kill me and failed. And I feel like every time we open up with that specific Audre quote, it kind of frees up a space for them to talk about every single thing that has ever tried to kill them and has failed. And it gives them a kind of power that they did not know they possessed, because sometimes things are trying to kill you and you don't even realize it. So when you put a name to something that you feel like is destroying you and you weren't even aware of it, and you realize, holy crap, I got over. I am alive. I am here. I made it. I won. Then it opens the door for all kinds of other conversations. So,
thank you.
My affinity for poetry started really in the quote-unquote the streets, right? Like, I'm not trying to say I was hood or street, but like, it was the gift of gab, the hustlers. I just always admired how they were able to talk their way out of things and stuff like that. So I became really, that's how I really became interested in language and how people were using language to manipulate one another. So when I teach the students, I don't call it poetry and performance, I call it learning how to talk your way out of detention class, right? And now I have done various things in terms of activism, including like I've gotten arrested with Occupy Wall Street, being on, you know, the front lines doing stuff like that. And none of it personally for me ever felt fulfilling. It never felt like, man, I'm doing all these things that all these other people are doing, but it's not fulfilling me, or I don't feel like I'm making my mark. And I start to feel like I started to make my mark when I was teaching. And instead of telling kids what to think or how to think, stuff like that, what I started to focus on, what I started to realize was working for me was getting them to read critically, to be critical readers, for them to be effective communicators, effective listeners, effective speakers. And I feel like so many issues in the world exist because people are not effective readers, effective listeners, or effective communicators. I cannot tell you how many fights in my own neighborhood could have been avoided if people just spoke with one another. Also, I come from a very diverse background, where my father's Puerto Rican and my mother's white. And I also have a large portion of my family is in the NYPD. So I was always caught in arguments with both sides. And what I came to realize was like, wow, like both sides don't know much about the other side, you know? So like, because I come mostly from a family large of like NYPD, so many of them didn't understand what was taking place on the other side. And I'm talking about my uncles and my father. Like, they didn't even understand the things that I felt or was experiencing. And it was just because, like I said, they weren't being effective listeners. There's that emotional tie, you know? They was like, you don't understand what it is to be NYPD and the things that you see every day, and it haunts you. And I said, I can understand all of that, but it's blinded you to the other side. It's blinded you to the other side of things that are going on. So with me, I just feel like for me, it was about being critical reader, an effective listener, effective communicator, a child who is not afraid to communicate and say how they feel, they're gonna have the kind of courage needed to bring about change. Because change is scary, and it requires a great deal of courage, especially for those who are speaking out. So like, the people who are on stage with me right now have a great deal of courage. And the people who are on stage with me now, even some of them who I've just met tonight, I am sure they have been in places where they were afraid, saying, man, you know, are my words about to fall on deaf ears? Or am I gonna have to be concerned about my safety after leaving a venue or leaving a place? So for me, that's where it comes from. If a child could be at a young age, right? They say the revolution is in the mind of a child. If at a young age, you could teach a child to be a critical reader and an effective communicator, then regardless of what my politics are, regardless of whatever the politics I would like to impart on them, I would just be making the world a better place if I could help people speak more often and effectively.
Thank you.
My name is Roy Marsh. I'm a black poet who refuses to remain silent while this nation continues to murder black people. I have a right to be angry. I also don't like holding phallic symbols towards my mouth, so hold that sideways and hope it picks up. I teach my young people and my adult people. I taught a preschool class today of four-year-olds. I taught collegiate level, and the oldest student I've taught is 84. Nice. All of them like to be news reporters, but of their own stories. I think that I want most importantly to encourage them to grant themselves access to their own truth and their own voices, to allow themselves to be heard as opposed to fearing that they won't be. There is a great power in being able to teach writing itself and this spoken word as a tool for therapy, as a therapeutic method, but not to therapize them itself, but to allow them to process, to eliminate things that they may have been ruminating over and over again and turn it into some tangible thing that they can crumple, throw in the trash, set on fire, give to someone that they may never be able to actually speak to vocally. And I think a great lesson for me is being able to share my blackness, which I definitely was born into without choice, but grew into with demand and command, and definitely stand in very truthfully and very strong, and to allow people, especially youth of color and queer youth of color, to know that they are not alone, that someone who looks just like them, who lives a lifestyle very similar to theirs, stands in front of this classroom and cares and listens and can also do the work and show them how to do the work and encourage them to do the work. And if they are not comfortable doing that work, that it is that is acceptable as well, that is okay. Whatever it is that their truth is, may they live in it forever.
Thank you, Roy. Thank you all for these. I'm learning a lot by listening to all of you, so I very much appreciate you sharing your experiences. I want to ask you about a question that I sometimes struggle with, and I'd be interested to hear if this is something that is a challenge for each of you or how you navigate through this contradiction. So a lot of us are affiliated in one way or another with organizations that are either by tradition or by law required to be nonpartisan, required to not choose a political side. I think as individuals, it can be easier to fall in line with that mission if there happens to be an administration that one sees eye to eye with. If, on the other hand, as for many of us is true now, one lives at a time when it is much harder to accept elements of, you know, the political order, how do we negotiate between what sometimes are the professional or even legal requirements that we have to be officially nonpartisan if we're speaking on behalf of an organization or as an instructor or in such a way that we are encouraged to allow young minds to make their own decisions while also trying to do what's right as individuals? Go ahead.
My name is Roya Marsh.
Uncompromising.
And I am a black poet who refuses to remain silent while this nation continues to murder black people. I have a right to be angry. In response to that question, I was actually asked on February 7th not to wear black anymore to one of the schools that I work in. And so my clothes have actually gotten blacker and blacker. It is now March 13th, and I haven't worn a different color at all since I was asked not to wear black anymore. And I will do that until June 26th, which is the last day of school, because I'm a black poet and have the right to wear whatever I would like. And I think in response to that question, I don't know if organizations should go into business with individuals that they don't think will represent their organization properly. And I think that that is similar to me with relationships. There are always signs of what this person is going to be doing, how they're going to be representing, and what behaviors or attitudes or political ideals, and what ways they will manifest, you know, as the partnership continues. And for any one person to think that they can hinder someone's self-expression, especially in the field of art, I think that's irrational.
Thank you.
I would say, actually, I did a professional development workshop with a middle school based in Brooklyn, in Brownsville, Brooklyn. And with the teachers, we actually talked about, like, you know, the idea of giving the young people, the children, space to talk about things. And they were like, no, we don't talk about politics. We don't talk about that. We, you know, we're just focusing on Common Core. We focus on teaching. We don't want to talk about, you know, that, because parents will come back and they're going to come here with their Make America Great Again hat and yell at us and say this and that and that and that and that. So the way that I had to, like, because I understand the idea. I totally get it, because I've worked in schools as well as with schools. So I understand the idea of the fear of, you know, little Timmy going home and saying, Mommy, Trump is the devil. And she's like, no, I love Trump. What are you talking about? Or Obama's amazing, and they don't agree, you know? That kind of battle that happens there. But the interesting thing about art is, because it's called self-expression, the idea for me is just, no one said you have to sit here and indoctrinate a child with what you believe in. But the big thing is that young people have questions. And I'm such a fan of the Socratic method. You ask me a question, I'm gonna ask you a question right back. Why do you think that is? Because in the same breath, even if I agree with a kid, I still say, they're like, Trump is evil. Why? Because I can tell you didn't come up with that on your own, young person. So why is that? Well, because he's bad. How? Well, he did this. Well, did he really do that? Where did you find that? Oh, my friend told me. Did you read? And I think that those ideas, just the idea of processing and thinking, and that's what art is in my brain. And one big element of art is art was a very good way to ask questions and have viewers and listeners ask questions of themselves and ask questions of where did the artist come from? Where was the artist there? And I think that for those that are confined by those spaces, that are in those spaces where it is, you are getting fired if you say certain things. And I understand, keep your livelihood. I will never tell you because I can't hire everybody. but it's simple as asking questions. I didn't tell you anything to do. You actually were able to come up with a conclusion for yourself. And if you can't do it for yourself, there's a problem. Go and get a book and figure it out.
Thank you.
As a father, that's something that concerns me in terms of, like, you know, having your child be indoctrinated. I agree, like what Chanel was saying, like questions. It's like let's have questions and to speak about that and you know, to question everything. And I've even been saying, even as a father, I'm saying it now, children should be questioning their parents. You know, respectfully, but they should always be questioning their parents. And as parents, if we're right, we're gonna have the right answer, or we're gonna remain in the right. You know, some of us are lazy and we're like, no, we can't go to the park now because something important's going on right now. When it's like, no, it's just you didn't want to go outside with your kid. So there are certain things, like I said, that I am concerned about that. But as an artist, right, like not as someone who runs an organization, but as an artist, I personally like the choir as much as the next person. But I also know that I've got to go into the spaces that may not be very accepting of my ideas. And maybe that's where I can bring about some change. So I may not be able to change someone completely, but maybe I could give them a little nugget to send down the road. So, you know, just a general example, not saying that this actually happened, but a general example. I don't know what everyone's politics are. I'm not a fan of Trump. I wasn't a fan of Clinton, but I'm not a fan of Trump. And so if I come, you know, if I'm able to gain access to an organization or a group of people who love Trump, maybe I can show them an aspect or a fact or challenge something that they believe about him that slowly may, you know, just tilt the mirror a little and they see life just a little differently. Like, oh, you're right, you know. Okay, I still like Trump, I don't like Clinton, but I can understand what you mean by Trump and not liking him, you know, because going around. But again, personally for me, going around, you know, and speaking to people about, like, you know, look at the oppression, look at the inequality that's going on, look at all this BS that they're doing with finances and all that. You know, I could shoot the shit with people all day long about that, and it won't bring about change. You'll just be like, oh, okay, we both agree, great, you know. But for me personally, at the age of 37, I've met a great deal of people I agree with. It's the people I don't agree with. What? I'm old? You didn't know I was that old? That's because I'm still good looking.
Hey, what are you trying to say about the people that's older?
So to end real quick, like I said, it's those challenging spaces that I personally like to go into because there are many places I could call home and I feel safe there and that's great, but the front line is not safe. Gotcha.
I wanted to say before that I've, like, learned how to be very subversive, you know, and I mean, I think that's a trait, you know, that African-American, certainly queer people, I mean, you know, women, we've had to do that in, you know, academic and teaching environments forever. And one of the ways that I do that is through the syllabus. So a lot of times, like, people have never even they're not even aware that most of the people that they've read are white, you know, or that, like, you know, women, there's not a majority of women on the syllabus, or there's not a majority of people of color, that they've never had an Asian person on the syllabus, they've never had a Latino person on the syllabus, you know, and so just by changing up the syllabus, basically that's an act of subversion. And basically there's a Zoe Leonard's piece, I Want a President, is on display at the High Line. and I participated in an event, and I mean, which is really, really incredible in the sense that it says, you know, I want a dyke for president. And I mean, like, you know, 20 years ago when I was coming out or something, to see something like that would have saved my life, you know? And still people go by it and they, you know, they cry and they have all these reactions. So to still see that in this era, in this time, is really, really radical. And for those who don't know, it's her poem. It's a poem, piece of visual art that they basically, she did, I think, in like 93 or something, and they've, you know, pasted it up on the High Line. And I think it's going to close soon. But I participated in the event for that, and because the High Line gets funds, I don't know, like they get a lot of different funding, but it has to be nonpartisan. And so, like, and it was right before the election. And it was like unbelievable that like we could not say publicly that we endorsed, you know, Trump. I mean that we endorsed, you know, Hillary. You know, so that was kind of bizarre. I mean, a part of me didn't want to do it, but then I thought about, you know, how do I approach this? And what I did was I rewrote the Martin Luther King's "I Have a Dream" speech, and so I went to the place of the dream. And basically to include women, to include LGBTQ people, to include people from different classes. So it was basically, how do we update this vision, right? And so that was my political statement, and then people like got it. But again, it goes back to the idea of how to be subversive, and we always have to figure that out.
Okay. Well, I think language is super important, right? Like the way that we use language, the way that we choose words is super important. So there are tons of ways to say whatever it is that you really want to say, right? That's first. Second, like for me, it's a little different. Like I feel like my friends and I, we have like a mob mentality. Like she'll tell you, like we mob everywhere we go. The takeover situation is real. So I feel like there isn't a place where we kind of step into that we don't make our own. And I think the other side of that is like, sometimes when somebody says that you can't say something, you have to say, keep your check, fam. Like, and that's it. And because the check will come from somewhere else. And at some point in time, you see, Roya won't open her mouth before she says, I am a black poet who refuses, like, you have to be uncompromising at something, for something. You have to be. So at some point, everybody has to say, nah, keep your money. Because I need to be able, like, I need to sleep at night. I need to be able to show my daughters that I have morals and values and that there are some things that I just will not stand for. And there are some things that money cannot make me revert or reverse my opinion or my beliefs or what I know to be actual and factual. Like, if I see something and I say, I look at it and it's like, psh, facts. If I see facts, I see no lies here, and you tell me that I can't say, I see no lies here, I don't need your check. It is what it is. Like, you either mob and you take over or you use the language. And you say things in a way, yep, that is different, or you say, no, I won't compromise. I want the green Skittles in my jar on my writer. Like, you don't compromise. So I feel like but that's just me.
You have time for me to answer it? Or you
gotta go ahead. All
right. You know, it's an interesting question. Anyone that knows me for years, I'm always on the I side of everything. I'm always like the I man now. I'm always Dolo. So it's almost like in these moments, even these political times, it's interesting for a person like me and people who are like me where there ain't no group that I can mob up with. There's no, like, you know, political
you
side.
You mob with us all the time.
I mean, I mob, but I like that point. But here's the reason why, though. It's like, I really have learned, and I'm going back to humanity again, I have to bring it back to that, because I am my own, you know, self-realization and personal awakening, I realized how much of our lives are spent fighting for the things that we believe define us, and they're the things that really divide us. It doesn't mean that I don't see the conflict within the world. It don't mean that I ain't going to war with certain things, but even when it comes to war, you should, like, even as a warrior, you have to see the humanity and the life and the thing you're going to war with. You get what I'm saying? And I think, so when it comes to me stepping into spaces, you know, I come in off the top, like there's an issue here. There's a purpose in which I'm here. There's a void that I have to fill. Now, I think when I bring the conversation to that human level, because we could throw out names like Trump and Hillary and everyone and whatever other political leaders, but when you get down to the root of it, there's a human need that's there. There's a fear that's there, and I address those things. You can't deny those things. You can argue a belief, but the experience is almost like undeniable. And I think just not even just within me, but all the great creators throughout history, all the great leaders are the ones who are able to rip right through all the noise and get down to the experience and put that on the stage, in which like audiences across the globe can't deny that this is what we're feeling. And so I think even in a lot of the movements that are happening right now, the challenge is, you know, people from every group is pretty much saying, can you not look at me as a human? You know, and so I think I always bring it down to that. And when you do that, it's almost like you kind of pull their cards and they have to let you do what you want to do. So.
Yeah, I appreciate all your answers. I have one more question for our panel, and then if there's time, we can take some questions from the audience. And it has a lot to do with what you were just talking about, the idea of cutting through the noise and focusing. We're in... Those of us on stage are all in a fairly left-leaning industry in a fairly left-leaning city that tends to be much less in favor of the current administration than it is in favor of it. There's a lot of advantages to being around relatively like-minded people, but one frustration that I hear from a lot of artists, a lot of students, a lot of activists is that right now there is an enormous amount of noise, and it might be noise in a direction a lot of people agree with, but I'd like to hear from each of you, how do you focus your activist and your artistic energies at a time like this? How do you focus when there are so many ways, so many organizations, so many individuals, so many talking heads and public figures who have their own take on what's wrong? How do we as artists, activists, educators focus our energies so that we don't exhaust ourselves, but still continue to push forward and continue to accomplish and achieve. Whoever wants to.
I got next. So I think it's important to choose what is important to you. Period. Like, you choose what's important to you. So let's just say the Women's March of the... I was supposed to do a poem there, right? I was supposed to do a poem, but my students... had a trip to the Hall of Science, right? A school-wide trip, 6th, 7th, and 8th grade. So for me, it literally came down to, okay, so do I go and hang out with these brown babies who I teach every day? Do I disappoint them and say I'm not coming because I'm gonna go perform and do poems to save the 53% of white women who voted for Donald Trump anyway, and now everybody has buyer's remorse, and because I'm not going to save the world on the backs of black women anymore. So I am going to choose to go and do my activism work, and my activism work is raising 6th, 7th, and 8th graders for hours on hours and on hours a day, and check my inbox on Facebook because they message me, and check my DMs on Instagram because they message me, and they wanna call me, and that's my activism work. So if I have to choose between saving the 53% of white women who voted for Donald Trump or the brown babies, I'ma choose those brown babies. It has to be what is important for you. I mean.
Just drop mic. Drops mic.
Drops mic.
I mean, low key, like, if I think of something else to say, but it comes down to that, like,
that's a hard act to follow, but.
I mean, I think that in adding to that, the idea of of filtering. You know, I know I have to take my news in doses. I cannot start my day off with the Daily Huffington Post news. I cannot do it. It will, I will get to work. And I remember one of the things where it's a very open office that I work in. And it would be like, y'all, guess what happened today? And they're like, oh, damn. And then we'd be mad for like a half an hour, hour. So it's just also monitoring how much we're intaking. We live in a society where information is always, always being processed, always being shoved down your throat, always being placed in the forefront. You got the Metro, you got the AM New York, you got it all over the place, and it's easily and readily accessible. But you still have to still guard the avenues of your mind, as they say. You know, you still have to be able to know that, one, whatever is going on in there, yeah, it's not necessary. It can very much change what's happening right in front of you, right? But I also have to be present. I have to make sure I'm taking care of myself. And a spa day goes a long way, whether that is through foam rolling, a day at the gym. But it's just that self-care aspect has to happen, that and you have to know what your limits are.
Well, I wanted to say before, one of the things that I do in terms of working with people is, it's not to talk at them, but basically to teach them how to think. Right, how to think critically. And I think that that's one of the things that's like lacking in this culture, is that a lot of people don't know how to think critically, you know? And so that's a strategy. So that's one of the things that, again, like my teaching work is part of my activism work. But one of the things that I've done, and it started as a fluke because I just finished a book, which is called Anime for Me, Tina Turner and All Black Women Survivors. But basically on Facebook, since I'm on Facebook a lot, I decided to basically create a character. And she's a slave woman. And she's narrating things that are going on the plantation. And so basically, I used it as a form of like social commentary, because if you say things outright on Facebook, basically people you just get a lot of fights and a lot of craziness. So I thought, you know, let me just say what I need to say from the perspective of this slave, right? And so people say that it's like it's part comedy and it's satirical, but it's also like a scathing indictment of the administration. And you know, because I call him master and I call Ivanka Mrs. and you know, and the whole thing. And actually I ran into like the provost of like NYU, and he's following some of the he's following the posts, right? And he said they're brilliant. And so one of the ways that I've decided to kind of like deal with this administration was to basically create something I thought was funny. I wasn't even taking it seriously, but basically it became a really important form of social commentary, right? That a lot of people are asking me to continue. So, I mean, there are so many ways that we can kind of take care of ourselves, or that I didn't have to get into some of those, like, you know, the news dialogues because they're so awful. But basically how I approach things, what I think is important, so I get to do satire and I get to do social commentary, and it's powerful.
You know, something that comes to mind, you just wanna throw in there, but ultimately the end thing is you gotta know what you're about. And yeah. But one thing when I look at a lot that's happening right now is that at the core, as humans, you see now more than ever that people want to belong. And a lot of these different movements, like a lot of the noise is from the peripheral people, like the few that know what's going on, they're really invested, and then there are people who want something to identify with, a place to say, yo, this is what I'm about, this is what I am. And it creates a lot of noise. And for that reason, I think for me, there's some compassion that has to go there. I used to get upset, like, why are they all talking? You know, but it's like I realize that's part of it. You know, it's like it's pretty much how like when two people have a beef, but the entourage is the ones who send the shots. It's like that, you know, because again, there's people who just want to be a part of something. When two sides are beef, and it's like, oh, I'm down with them. I'm down with them. Like, and it's there's a part of that I don't know what it is. But I think in that as well, though, you know, just to, again, echo it again, it's important to know what you're about. I think the challenge is when you feel that whatever your stance or experience is has to be the absolute human experience and everyone has to even know how you feel, it becomes real dicey at that point. I think there's a point where you have to, again, claim your struggle, your mission, your objective, your purpose, and have that being for you be enough and commit your life to it and not rely on any outside validation, you know, of its importance. And when you can do that, I think you can allow, you know, this ecosystem of conflict to, you know, to exist.
Thank you.
I'm gonna do my best to not repeat what everyone else said, because a lot of people said things I would add. So what I would add on is that for me, there has not been that great of a change within the political system and in our society. For me, and that is because I don't just look to mainstream media to tell me how to feel. Police killing unarmed black people seems to be something that's been so new, and the numbers are rising in the last 5-7 years, and it's not true. It's been going on. It's just that all of a sudden it seems to be in the news.
And we have YouTube.
Right? The toys have changed. Right? Like, so society hasn't changed, but the toys have changed.
Access.
Yeah, so now it's getting to be seen more, you know? Latinos being deported. There were record-breaking numbers within the Obama administration. I expect no less from the Trump administration, right? So for me, that hasn't changed. Women fighting for their rights hasn't changed. I mean, you look at the stories of Edward Bernays, and in 1930s, 40s, the feminist movement, the tobacco company took that over to raise their prices. Do you know? So when we hear, oh, the feminist movement or Black Lives Matter or Occupy Wall Street, you know, there's subversion, there's Agent 800, there's people coming in here and, you know, trying to ruin it. That's been going on. You know, like, so I don't feel there is more noise today than there was in the 90s. Or in the 80s. I mean, I was in the single digits in the 80s, but I remember the fear of, like, my parents saying, you can't go here, and you can't go here, and that all these different places are scary. And so for me, you know, nothing's changed, but like we said, the toys. And now people are finding out, oh, my God, unarmed black boys are being killed by police? And my reaction is, although it's gotten less angry, because I guess I've gotten used to it, I've been desensitized, unfortunately, is, where the fuck you been? You know, you get a YouTube account and now you know what's going on in the world. Like, this stuff has been going on. Jobs leaving, Wall Street taking over, banks doing dirty deals, Federal Reserve, all this stuff is old news. And it keeps repeating, you know, itself. And you can even see that in looking at the poems, right? Like, you can listen to poems from the 20s, from the 30s. If you're a man, you can listen to a poem from a woman. If you're black, you can listen to a poem from a white person. If you're white, you can listen to a poem from the black person. From like the mid-1900s, and you still feel like, oh my God, that feeling. I know what that feeling is. You know, people talking about the Iraq wars just like the Vietnam War. You know, a new toy is a new place. It's the same thing. So I think for an artist, you know, in the beginning, especially as an artist wants to be active, every fight and war is the front line, and you've got to be on every single one of them. And then I had a friend, you know, speak to me, and he said, well, you know, you don't live alone in the world. You got to trust other people. And he wasn't talking about activism, but when he said that, I kind of took that on, and it was like, you know, it's right. Like, so if I'm putting my energy into the youth, I have to recognize I'm not the only person in the world. And hopefully there are other people out there fighting a good fight on different fronts, because you could wear yourself so thin, even in a Facebook argument where the thread has 150 comments, you can be worn so thin. And so, like everyone else said, pick your battles.
My name is Roy Marsh. I am a black poet who refuses to remain silent while this nation continues to murder black people. I have the right to be angry. Black itself is not a color. It absorbs all of the colors of the visible spectrum and reflects none of them, which is to say, I am the noise. Nice. I don't like the videos. I don't share the videos. I don't watch the videos. What I do in response to that is swipe people of color in on the train when they're looking for one.
Yes.
Because 275 is no reason to have a record. Because if you don't have 275, you don't have $100 to pay the fine, which means you now have a court date, which means you don't have the money to pay for a lawyer, which means you will end up with a record. Therefore, I'm still black, and I will not be silent, and I'm angry as hell.
Thank you all. I wish we had a lot more time to go through all of this, because these are some amazing artists, and I love hearing what y'all have to say. How are we doing on time? Do we have a little? Okay, all right. Are there some questions from the audience? There was someone.
Talkative bunch, huh?
Well, I think all these answers are tough acts to follow, and it's... I'm learning a lot listening to all of you, and I think we're lucky as a city and lucky as an arts industry to have such eloquent and impassioned spokespeople and artists and activists who are championing the causes that you all are passionate about. Anything else from the audience? Oh yeah, go for it.
Because what artists do, and I think a lot of you pointed to that, it just cuts through all of that in terms of sticking to what we've always been doing as artists in terms of speaking truth looking at humanity and how do you think critically? How do we figure out who we are and love ourselves and things like that? And those are things that it's not red or blue. That's kind of stuff that carries us through every administration. And I think it should be taught. Those kinds of things. You are all doing it, so I just want to thank you. It's amazing.
Thank you.
And I hope to get you all to La Casita, because I'm also curating there, and I know that you're there.
Yeah.
So it's great. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
I know all of you almost teacher and activist at the same time, and I was curious, have you ever... Mayor's wife is African American, if I'm not mistaken. Have you guys tried to engage them, to make change in the community, or just
engage who?
Engage the politicians, like a mayor's office or other.
Oh, I have. I work with Community Board 8, but they are so full of crap. On both sides of the aisle, I've sat down with. Both sides of the aisle. I have sat down with Republicans, I've sat down with Democrats. I don't care what their gender is, what their political aspect is. It's all bullshit. I have met and come in, I don't want to put some names out there, but I've met some people like, oh my God.
You kind of did by saying what community board you were in.
Like, this is great. Right, community board, Northwest Bronx, community board 8.
Oh my God.
So, I'm like, great, I'm meeting with this person. I know their stance and this and that and da, da, da. And then they're like, but how does this help me? And how does this help? Like, they have no problem. It's gotten to that point, they have no problem saying, but yeah, but how is it gonna help me? How's it gonna help me get reelected? And there was one time I tried to speak with a politician, didn't want to talk with me. Year and a half later, I'm seeing him on 231st and Broadway trying to shake everyone's hand because he had to get elected. And I went up to him, I said, oh, are you ready to talk now? You're ready to talk? Oh my, Oliver Coppell is ready to talk with me, ladies and gentlemen.
Oh,
amazing. Because it gets upsetting. When you get into the political arena, if you're not a monster, it makes you a monster. And it's very hard for people to not become a monster and be part of it. And that's when I had started to slowly move away. And I was like, nah, screw this. So that's just me, sorry.
But I think it's also fear, right? So, in terms of the mayor and his wife, whatevs, like.
But Shirlane is a poet.
Like, no, but
yeah,
my
his wife, yeah.
But they invited my best friend until they saw that she was blackety black, 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 and then disinvited her. So there's that. But there are things that happen like that. But like fear of just how does this align with my message? Does this help me? I mean, we could look back to Obama and Jeremiah Wright, right? How he had to, politically, he had to distance himself from Jeremiah Wright, even though what he was saying was taken out of context or the entire message wasn't being shown. So, I mean, it really is about fear and who you're connected to and, you know, that kind of thing. Yeah, I don't know. I just can't.
Well, one of the things that I try to do is to get people to engage where they want to engage or to feel empowered to work in a lot of different areas. So someone might, you know, work in local government. Somebody might, you know, write a book. I came from the New School, and basically every single graduate went into some aspect of social justice, right? Every single one of us. Not all the same one, you know, but the quality of the education was so good at that time that we all basically ended up in some aspect of social justice. And so hopefully in the education that we're all providing, that, you know, people will find their voices and find their path to work in the areas. I mean, what I'm trying to do is not just to empower myself, but to empower everyone to find their particular voice and their particular in where they want to work, you know?
Yeah, I think, yeah, what she said, that she hit a major, I know, right, but you hit a major note. For me, my direct answer to your question is personally, no. I don't reach out to politicians and try to get them to further my message. I understand and not respect as an agreement, but I see what they're about. I think for me, I'm more hands-on with the community. The black community is honestly my concern. It doesn't mean that other communities aren't important, but my true concern are the kids in my neighborhoods, like the ones I grew up in. I do, you know, for me though, I have friends that for them, that's their mission. They're going the political route. And so for me, I think one of my outlook is you should have people everywhere, you know? My friends who work in politics, they're not writing poems, they don't teach, and I'm not gonna tell them to go teach. You know, I think you should have people in specific areas.
Satan sees his household all the time.
Right.
I was gonna say, I actually work with a lot of different politicians.
You do.
Aren't they all
actually, see, this is the thing. I think that, I will say this, and when we speak to, I work with elected officials. And I will say this, this is something, and I've lobbied, I do that as well. I've done that for lupus as well as for education and funding for TAP. And I've done that for many years. I do think that there is, once again, this kind of understanding of the realm that we're in, right? And understanding also, and this sounds terrible, but it's real, because as talked before, the idea of being able to finesse a message and also to find where the middle ground is. Because I think that that's the other side of it, where it's like, yo, let's be real. You can't do, that person can't do anything if they're kicked out of office, if they're not elected. That person can't do anything. They can't. Now, of course, there always is that fine line between right and wrong, and there's that fine line between help and not help at all. But I think one of the things that it's been effective in many respects is finding out what that person's stance is. And yeah, how does this help you? You don't even have to ask me that. That's what I lead with. You know, I think that politics, I do think that while I know that this world is very, very corrupt, in all genres, in art, in every genre, there is some level of corruption in it. And there is a lot of how does this help further my career and my life? And I'm like, okay, you want to further your career in life? That is perfectly fine. This is what I need you to do. This is what you can do. And I think that in the world we live in, we have to be realistic and also be creative and coming up with the ways that we can partner and meet in the middle ground. And, it's very hard. It's very hard to, I will never demonize anybody for trying to further their best interest. I will never demonize you. I understand it. It is a human natural thing to try to make sure you're going to live. You're going to be okay. You have family to feed. You know what you want in the future. I do agree with you in the idea of trying to find ways to bring, because I talk to kids all the time. They're like, I want to be a lawyer. I'm like, why do you not want to be a judge? Why do you not want to be chief justice? You know, you want to do this. Why do not, I have the gift of gab and be a businessman. No, why don't you become a politician? You know, and those are the ways that we further that, and that is just outside of art. That's outside of it. That's just a part of like expecting life and trying to grow the world around us.
My name is Ray Marsh, and I am a black poet who refuses to remain silent while this nation continues to murder black people. I have a right to be angry. I was actually asked to perform for the aforementioned politicians for free. I was told what poems I could not do. So I did the blackest, gayest, raunchiest, most profane poem that I had. And I walked out drunk with $420 in chapbook sales. So I'm pushing the envelope as far as I can. I wasn't asked to leave. I was invited to three more corporations to perform. And I think for me, I'm not asking anyone to do anything or to try to do anything. I'm doing it, I'm leading by example, and I'm showing them that I am someone that they need to follow.
If I could quickly piggyback off of politicians are public servants. They're supposed to be afraid of us and work for us, not for them. So I love how you're setting the tone. And you're like, nah, screw you. Y'all
well,
come
I'm a black poet who refuses to remain silent.
That's right.
Absolutely. That is a powerful note to end on. I think, ladies and gentlemen, unless there's any, are there any more questions? Anything else from the audience? We are very, very, you have something else you want to say?
No, okay.
Well, I'm personally very grateful, and I'm very impressed, and I've learned a heck of a lot from everything you all have to say. If you like what you heard today, first of all, each of these poets has websites. They have chat books. They also perform and teach throughout the area, and we are very grateful to have them here. You can hear these poets and others like them at the Nuyorican Poets Cafe, and if you like, in particular, anything that you heard from tonight, talk to that poet, find out how to get in touch with them, and we are grateful to you all. Thank you very much. And very grateful to the Graduate Center and to Frank and Rebecca for making this possible. Thank you much.